answering questions until notified by our guest. Tonight, it's Mr. Stephen Dr. Greer himself. And I want to give us a brief introduction of him. He is the godfather of CSETI. CSETI is a Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence. Also, he is the Orion Project founder and the Sirius Disclosure Project founder. He comes tonight with so much knowledge and information, and I want to start off by saying we're going to get into the Podesta connection. We're going to talk about a sighting in Vero Beach, Florida. Also, we're going to talk about a collaboration with the bestseller author, Stephen Alton, I believe his name is. Good evening, Doctor. I am excited to have you here. Please take it away for us right here. Thank you.
Yeah, well, I'm very happy to be here. I founded the Disclosure Project and CSETI some 25 years ago, and a lot of what we've done is to bring forward all the classified information that we've been able to obtain on projects related to UFOs and extraterrestrial intelligence. And, that all got started because the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, which was the parent beginning project, actually had made contact with an extraterrestrial civilization on the beach of Florida back in 1992, and it ended up in the news. And then the next thing you know, we had people from Army intelligence and CIA contacting us, asking us what in the hell we were doing. And it's sort of a very interesting story of how our initiative as ambassadors to the universe, which is really how we started, has evolved into these other projects. First, the Disclosure Project, which, I sort of founded that whole worldwide movement, and it's now resulted in about 15 countries opening all their secret UFO files. And then from that, the Orion Project, which is a project related to trying to bring out the classified energy and propulsion technologies behind what people call UFOs. And, most people don't realize that the secrecy on the subject and all the misinformation and disinformation is centered primarily, although not exclusively, on the fact that if it was disclosed that we're not alone and that there are civilizations capable of going faster than the speed of light, that it would open up an entire area of physics, which we call transdimensional physics, that would pretty much terminate the oil, gas, coal, and related fossil fuel industries. And so, many people think the secrecy is because there's something scary out there. I said, no, there's something really scary here on Earth. It's called the greed and stupidity of certain types of humans.
Absolutely. Hello, Mr. Greer?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you tell us about Florida? I am curious. I saw the video. The video was, how did you know that they were going to appear there and that time and the date that you were there in January?
Well, the central purpose of our project is to train people from all over the world to become ambassadors from Earth to these other civilizations, which we can prove are visiting us. So if people go to our website, which is SiriusDisclosure.com, Sirius like the star system or SiriusXM, S-I-R-I-U-S, Disclosure.com, it's all one word, there's a whole section of evidence you can click on. And in that section, you're going to find several dozen top secret military people's testimony about this, documents, images, photographs, you name it. Since we can prove that we're being visited, what I posited when I first started the CSETI was that, well, perhaps we should reach out and make contact with them in a diplomatic and peaceful fashion, because to be honest with you, the only response they've gotten from humans to date or up till that time was either a military response, which was not nice, or denial, and sort of people sticking their head in the sand.
Right.
So we decided, let's do something proactive, let's do something forward-looking and become, you know, ambassadors representing humans to these civilizations. So I started what's called the CE5 Initiative and Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind. And a close encounter of the fifth kind basically is when humans initiate or cooperate with a contact event with an interstellar civilization, and it results in some sort of a contact event, and it can be any type of contact event. It can be a sighting, it can be a craft very nearby, it can be teleported ET beings that are right in the circle around us, which we have actually had happen. There's photographs of one at Joshua Tree from a couple years ago up on our website. So what the purpose of that, of course, is to not sort of have people get excited because they've seen something, but it's a deeper meaning in that we're inviting these civilizations to make contact with us, and they respond. So at the instant you have a response, then you've opened a diplomatic portal, as it were, from humans mm-hmm. to them. And this is, of course, a very pioneering effort and enormously controversial, even amongst UFO folks. But I felt that that was the missing link that no one had thought to do, because all the research up until the time we started the CE5 initiative had been a retrospective research initiative, retrospective meaning looking backward and collecting cases of landings or cases of sightings or pilot sightings or radar tracings of these objects, whereas what I thought was, well, that's fine, and we have several hundred thousand cases like that, literally, I'm not exaggerating. We have 4,000 cases where they've landed and left physical evidence. We have several thousand radar cases. So at a certain point, notwithstanding the mainstream media's denial of all this, we said, okay, we can make the case we're being visited. The question is, now what? What do you do after that? So this is the answer to that, and it's really a very visionary effort, and we now have thousands of people. Oh, if you go to our website, seriousdisclosure.com, there's actually a link to a training app that you can put on your smartphone that'll take people through the entire process of training how to make contact using a number of protocols, which we can get into maybe in a little bit, and how those work. And there's another app that's a free app that will you can download that will show where there are other people in your region or city or state that are also wanting to do this, so you can meet up with them and form contact groups. So
you know, there
we
was
launched
one
that
just
about a year ago, and now they're, I mean, literally every continent and almost every single country on the planet now have the CE5 ambassador contact teams, and that's really been exciting. That's something anyone can do from their home, meeting with like-minded people in their area. And it's amazingly it's very simple to do. The concept behind it is something that's sort of more radical, and that is, rather than passively seeing a UFO go by, why don't you do something to initiate contact with it and open up some sort of dialogue of some type? And that's what we're suggesting, because ultimately, to blow the lid off the secrecy on this, there's several things we have to do. One is make contact openly and bypass the government, which is utterly corrupt and incompetent. The other is, of course, what we've been doing with the Disclosure Project and gather more and more insider, whistleblower testimony, people who have been inside military, corporate or intelligence operations who will come forward. And that's the some five or six dozen videotapes we have up on our website that anyone can see if they want to click through there and look at them. But I think we want to bring more of those people forward. And so those two approaches are really how we've been advancing disclosure on the UFO subject around the world, but within the context of a peaceful contact. What we've been trying to also do at the same time is to really make a distinction between what we're doing and sort of what you normally hear on this subject, which is usually terrifying to people, completely untrue, heavily crafted disinformation that's designed to result in a fear response, because what we discovered back about 1994, 95, is that there has been a long-term plan since the 50s to put out false information about this subject that portrays it as a threat, and in doing so, lay the foundation for a future interplanetary war. And a lot of people are amazed to hear that no less a figure than General Douglas MacArthur, in his last speech to the Congress in 1956, said World War III will be interplanetary. And, you know, Ronald Reagan at the United Nations said, wouldn't our job of uniting the world be easier if there was a common alien threat to unite against and fight? And we have Wernher von Braun, who invented the rocket for Adolf Hitler's. He, on his deathbed, told his right-hand assistant, who's now a member of our team, Carol Rosen, that there had been this long-term plan to hoax a threat from outer space that did not exist in a false flag operation designed to kind of unite the world in a militaristic junta, or a militaristic sort of order in the world that would focus on some threat out there. And he said it was just completely all a lie. And this is something that if you go to a normal kind of UFO New Agey conference, I would say 90%+ of the people presenting are unwittingly, usually, are presenting information that's designed to create this emotional fear response, which, of course, has to be done if you want people to hate someone enough to go to war over it. I mean, of course, Adolf Hitler did that to great success against the Jews and against gay people and gypsies and anyone else that he didn't like. And you can see that this is done all throughout history, where demagogues and leaders, whether they be religious or political, will create a demon out there to unite their populace against and enable them to then have enough hatred to make the sacrifice in blood and treasure to go to war. But what most people don't realize is that this has been a sort of sub rosa agenda that's been operating since the 1950s on this subject, and that what I call mainstream UFO research is just completely polluted with this kind of nonsense. So one of the things I thought that had to be done is to provide some clarity on that, but also a response that's more positive, where humans get together and say, okay, they're here, they're from other star systems, there are probably dozens of different types of civilizations out there. They're waiting for us to become peaceful and grow up a little bit. Why don't we become the leading edge, as it were, a pioneering effort to make peaceful contact with them? And so that's how the CE5 initiative started in 1990. That was 25 years ago. And, you know, I'm working full-time as an emergency doctor when I started this endeavor. And what I found was that the very first times we went out using these set of protocols that I've developed, we had contact. And so it made it very clear to me that the ETs were eager to make contact with us, but they hadn't had a point of contact. In other words, there was no one doing this. There was the State Department wasn't doing it. The military was approaching them in a militaristic and violent way. The United Nations had acknowledged this issue a few times. But
do we have interstellar weapons in our atmosphere at the moment? Are there interstellar weapons that are knocking these ships down or coming from the atmosphere? Because when I looked at the video, you had mentioned that one of them had went down into the ocean. And it makes me think, like, you know, some of them aren't leaving the atmosphere because they're you know, shooting them down, especially in the U.S.
Yes, well, it's not just U.S. I mean, once you have a system that's in space, it doesn't matter. You can be in any over any territory. And as you know, if you've read the disclosure book, and by the way, there's a 2-hour and 4-hour DVD of all these military men and women speaking. There's also a 500-page book that has the documents and transcripts of their testimony called Disclosure. That's all at our store at seriousdisclosure.com. But one of those accounts by a Marine security officer when he was on the Peruvian-Bolivian border back in the early 90s, was a situation where we tracked one of these ET craft in our atmosphere and then targeted it with a weapon, some type of electromagnetic scalar weapon, and it crashed near the border there, and he was one of the first people, along with his sergeant, to get there on the site where it had crashed. And so, you know, this has been going on for decades, and don't forget that, you know, the Tesla scalar-type electromagnetic technology, even though it's been kept very secret, was being experimented with in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, so that by 1947, when Roswell happened, a lot of people don't realize that Roswell was a crash of a UFO. However, it was not an accidental crash. We had put in a new electromagnetic installation there that looked like a radar dome, and it wasn't. It was actually one of these scalar systems, and it did knock it down. Now, between the 40s and the 60s, we began to move these onto platforms that were in orbit in space. And yes, they have been used to target ET craft. And one of the big problems that I have seen and that I've had meetings at the Pentagon about is that there is a clandestine and quite out of control group that's doing this that simply does not answer to the president or to the Congress, and is pretty much a fourth branch of government going off doing what it wants. And because of that, it's really created an existential crisis and a constitutional crisis that nobody really wants to talk about, to be honest with you. And,
speaking of Obama.
Yes, by far the biggest crisis in the history of the United States since 1776. And I say this with some knowledge of history. I mean, much worse than even the Civil War, because the entire chain of command and constitutional legal system was basically dissembled in the mid-1950s. And the Rockefeller Commission of 1956 basically decided that they would make the Department of Defense and the CIA so labyrinthine and hard to penetrate and compartmentalize that no president since Eisenhower has had any sense of being able to penetrate what these projects are doing. And certainly no congressional committee has. And I've met personally with a sitting CIA director for Bill Clinton. I've personally briefed the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, the Minister of Defense for Great Britain and Canada, and you know, members of the Senate Intelligence Committee of the United States, and the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee of the United States, and on and on. And in each and every one of these meetings, what I found out was that they were very interested in this subject, but they had no access or control over what these projects were doing. So once we discovered that, we said, boy, we really do need to ramp up this effort at a citizen's diplomacy. And that's what we were doing at on the beach about a month ago in Florida, Vero Beach, and we were using these protocols to basically vector or guide these craft into our location. And there were these two massive golden spheres that appeared out over the ocean. And now, of course, there have been people who have debunked it, saying, oh, those had to be flares. Well, they're not flares. There's no smoke. There were no ships in the area on the surface of the ocean, and there were no aircraft in the air anywhere around there. And I was looking with very advanced a $4,000 pair of night scope binoculars, and we had this entire thing filmed. By the way, anyone who wants to see it can go to our website, and there's a link there for you to see it. And we've researched every other kind of phenomenon that's been known in the air and there's nothing to explain what this was. The other thing is that while we were doing this, we had a magnetic field detector, what's called a magnetometer, and other electronic devices in the circle with us, and they all started signaling at the same time this event happened, and there was nothing that would explain those electromagnetic signals going off, because it was we were just out on an open beach at a state park near Vero Beach, so actually a county park, and so this event, which lasted several minutes, was filmed, and then of course it was preceded by a number of sightings which we didn't get filmed, and then followed by quite a bit of this electromagnetic activity that was very unusual. And it was a training program. We do these a few times a year where we just take people out and train people to do it for an entire week. And it's a really exciting program because part of it involves people learning to do what's called remote viewing, where you enter into a meditative state and learn to be able to see remote places in space with your consciousness. And a lot of people say, what does that have to do with contacting ETs? I said, well, do you think that they're using electromagnetic signals that go at the speed of light? No. They're using technologies that interface with coherent thought, just like a laser is coherent light. And this gets into a whole discussion of what does it mean to be an interstellar civilization? Well, it means you're not using something like a 747 or an iPhone or a telephone to communicate. That's all 1800s type technologies and mid 1900s. You know, a lot of people don't realize that electromagnetic radio signals, I mean, that's 1844 with the telegraph, first telegram sent. So you're dealing with civilizations that are using technologies that go beyond 3D and 4D and cross into these other higher dimensions. And yet they are planetary civilizations. But this is the natural evolution of technology. And, you know, of course, in classified projects, they've already experimented with this. But the general public doesn't know about it. One of my jobs is to try to bring this information out to people and say what kind of not only philosophical construct do we need to make contact peacefully, but what kind of scientific knowledge do we have to have? Because you can't go into doing this with the knowledge of the mid-1800s, which is what most people think is high-tech. Everyone thinks their computer and their smartphone is so high-tech, but it isn't. The basic technology it's using is 150 years old. So there's really nothing fantastic about it. And I know Silicon Valley people hate to hear me say that, but it really is true. And then the same thing on the transportation point. These craft don't have to move linearly in like an airplane. They can just materialize out of one dimension and cross into this one, which is what happened at the beach, at Vero Beach. Mm-hmm. And most people can't understand how that happens because they haven't been educated on the physics of either the science of consciousness or the physical sciences that are transdimensional that deal with transportation and communication, which cross beyond the speed of light into these other dimensions. And I think that's, to me, one of the most exciting things about what we're experimenting with and what we're experiencing is being able to begin to open up our minds to this sort of a glimpse into our own future by seeing these civilizations that have kind of come this way before us and who have managed to survive to the point that they've grown to be an interstellar species.
Yeah, I believe you're talking about a spiritual technology that is prehistoric and very archaic. And it's actually, you know, a built internal technology that we have always had, but perhaps lost in rediscovering now.
The fact is we've always known that the mind is infinite. And a lot of people don't realize that Nikola Tesla was tutored by Dr. Walter Russell, whose Swannanoa Institute is 10 minutes from my farm here in Virginia, near the University of Virginia. And this is what he really focused on. He wrote a book called The Universal One, talking about this, the science and this connection. And this goes back, whether you go to the ancient Vedas, ancient Egyptian knowledge, ancient knowledge of South American native peoples. They all had a knowledge of this. Now, what I'm talking about is that then can be put into a technological system. Mm-hmm. And that's where it gets to be really fascinating. So it's you have the hardware and the software, as it were, of your mind and consciousness and body. Now imagine having technological devices that seamlessly interface with thought and consciousness. That's what we're talking about with these civilizations. So you have to understand that to understand what we're doing when we go out under the stars and do this as teams of people. And that's why I put this whole training program together. And, you know, there's the app that trains people, but there's a whole training kit and program that's also at our store, at our website, that people can get. And I encourage anyone who's curious about this to do it, because they'll find that if they just start experimenting with it, either alone or with a small group of people, they'll be stunned at the kinds of experiences they'll begin to have.
Absolutely. I'm enjoying this show. We are live with Dr. Greer. And I need to go to a break right now. When we come back, we're going to get into the Podesta. We'll be back.
John Podesta is the senior advisor to the President of the United States. Yes.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Greer, for that correction. And we'll be back in 2 minutes. This is Sophia Ray, and we are back live with Dr. Greer. Thank you, Dr. Greer. Can you get into a little bit of the Podesta, Obama's advisor, in the whole disclosure thing? I'm interested.
Yeah, well, this, you know, most people probably know that in 2001 at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., after I had discovered that the president, Bill Clinton, and his CIA director had been denied access to these projects, I put together 110 military guys to come forward with testimony and documents in the first wave of disclosure witnesses on the fact that we're not alone in the universe. And we decided to do a National Press Club event with about 24 of them. And that was the largest National Press Club event since Ronald Reagan had been in the building back in the 80s. And it was seen by around 800 million people around the world. So that launched the worldwide disclosure movement. And as a consequence, a man who had been chief of staff for the President of the United States, Bill, at the time, back in the 2000s, was Bill Clinton. And Bill Clinton's chief of staff for, I think, 4 years was a man named John Podesta. He's the founder of the largest think tank in Washington called the Center for American Progress. And he came forward publicly in 2002 after we did this disclosure event, and basically endorsed that there should be the end of secrecy and that the American people need to know the truth about UFOs and that it shouldn't be kept secret anymore. Well, fast forward a few years, and a man named Barack Obama becomes President of the United States. Well, Obama asked John Podesta to put together the cabinet. So during the transition period between the election in November of 2008, and when he took office in January of 2009, Podesta helped him put together his cabinet, his national security team, all those sort of folks. And after that, a man who knew John Podesta and was actually attending a course with him at Georgetown University reached out to me and said, you know, we really need to get a briefing to the president on all of this. And I said, yes, this is something I'm working on. And let's get this to John Podesta to get to President Obama. So I put together a very extensive brief, the cover letter of which was about 7 pages long, is on our website that you can find under one of the headings. I think it's under papers. And research papers. So I put that briefing together, and at the same time, there was a man that I knew who was friends with Leon Panetta, who was the CIA director, the first CIA director for Obama, and later became Secretary of Defense for Obama. And so we got the same briefing to him. And the reason, you know, I do these sorts of things, first of all, I have points of contact to these sort of folks in government. But secondly, I feel that even though they're not being told what the truth is. They need to know what the truth is. And who's going to tell them? So a lot of people say, well, can't they call in on the Presidential Daily Brief, the PDB, which is done every day by the CIA director, and just get that info? I said, no, because if the CIA director is being lied to about this or is being denied access, how would he put together a briefing for him? So what our team has done basically over the years has become sort of another pathway to put together evidence and testimony and assessments and intelligence briefings that I put into these briefings that then can go to either the president or to a member of Congress or to a minister of defense in Europe or whoever. And this has become something that I never thought I would be doing, to be honest with you. It was never my intention to be in this situation. But so Podesta did not want to be part of the Obama administration. He just assembled the cabinet for him and was an advisor. And then a couple years ago, he actually did become part of the administration as senior advisor to the president of the United States. And now, of course, I was very encouraged to hear that because I know John Podesta is very pro-disclosure. He's very pro-ending secrecy on the UFO issue. Of course, it doesn't mean that the president can do a whole lot about it since he's surrounded by a lot of people who are invariably going to lie to him about this stuff. But having someone very friendly to disclosure as the most senior advisor to the president of the United States is a very good thing. So John Podesta, when he left that position a week or two ago, actually tweeted that one of his biggest regrets was not being able to effect disclosure. And I was sort of surprised that he would do that. A lot of people at first thought, was he joking? But he wasn't joking, because you can Google it back to 2002 and see where he had a press conference with some former generals and other people where they were all calling for, as a follow-on to what we did in 2001, ending the secrecy on this issue. And I think it's very encouraging that John Podesta is still a stalwart supporter of ending this secrecy. But the backstory is what I'm sharing with you, and that is he was the man, the point of contact that we gave the presidential briefing to that I was preparing in 2009, the first year of Obama's presidency. I think it actually went to him in 2010, about 5 years ago. But this is a really significant development that someone at that level, who is the most senior advisor to the president of the United States, would openly tweet and comment on the fact that he regrets that he hasn't been able to assist at the level of the presidency of having disclosure happen. And the backstory to this, I'm going to be doing a workshop for 4 or 5 hours in Washington, D.C. on March 29th. Anyone listening who wants to come, if you go to our website, which is, again, SiriusDisclosure.com, S-I-R-I-U-S, Disclosure.com, there's a little blue thing at the top that talks about the briefing on March 29th, and you can click on there and register to come to that, because what I'm going to do during that entire afternoon session is to go back and analyze how we got where we are now, where the senior presidential advisor would be making a comment like this, but what happened between 1992 and 2015 in terms of the kinds of meetings that we had, how we reached this assessment that the projects were being run illegally. And by the way, the foundation for our going forward with all of this top secret information, and no one has gotten in trouble, by the way, for this, and the reason they haven't is that we made a statement that to every branch of the government that said that unless we were directed otherwise, we were going to come forward with this information, because the projects that were key keeping all this secret, we're doing so illegally, without the knowledge and consent of the people, the president, the oversight committees in the Congress, such as the Senate Intelligence Committee or Senate Oversight Committees, etc. And that for that reason, any person who would come forward with documents, information about this, who had worked for a contractor like Lockheed Martin, the big aerospace company, or Northrop Grumman, which is my uncle's old company. My uncle worked on designing the lunar module that took the first man to the moon, interestingly. So this issue runs through my family. And or anyone who's worked for the CIA, Department of Defense, military, Air Force, whatever, that they can come forward without any fear of reprisals because they're not violating their security oath, because the entities that are keeping this secret are doing so illegally. And since their operation is illegal, they can't cite any law to protect themselves. So one of the things that I keep saying, anyone listening needs to listen very carefully. If you have documents or information firsthand, I don't care about hearsay from third and fourth hand parties, or second hand even, firsthand knowledge, and you've been in these sort of operations, you should contact us at our website. There's a special how to contact me through the website if you are such a person. I don't want to hear from other people who just have heard rumors of rumors of rumors. We don't have time for that. And by the way, it has no credibility. But if you are such a person, you can come forward, and there is no one who can do anything against you. And of the several dozen men and women who came forward, have come forward so far, none of them have been prosecuted, none of them have been bothered. And the reason for it is that they are doing the correct thing, because we already established between 1992 and 2000 that the projects that they had been either involved with peripherally or reporting to were in fact illegal operations. And if they're illegal, it's basic constitutional law. It's like the mafia. If you get into a contract and sign an agreement with the mafia, the mafia can't enforce that. Well, these covert programs that are so secretive that they lie to a president or lie to a CIA director that I personally briefed. I mean, this is not conspiracy theory on my part. I spent 3 hours with a sitting CIA director when he was the CIA director. And I can assure you that, you know, the guy wasn't acting. I mean, he was shaken to his foundation about this. And so my feeling about it is that anyone who has this kind of information needs to not walk but run to their computer, send me an email. And what we really want to do, in addition to this global contact initiative, is also have a whole second wave of disclosure, having more and more of these sort of people coming forward from inside these covert programs, these secretive programs. And, you know, it may be someone who worked for Booz Allen Hamilton or SAIC or Lockheed Martin or, you know, the whole gamish of contractors. But it doesn't really matter whether you were in the government or a contractor for these programs. The programs are themselves illegal, and therefore you can talk about them all you want. And this is why we have done this. And a lot of people don't realize that we put this together. And you know, Daniel Sheehan, who's a constitutional attorney, who actually had worked, represented the New York Times in the Pentagon Papers, and also the Silkwood case and the Kerr-McGee nuclear scandal in Tennessee with the Silkwood case, that most people have seen the movie Silkwood. He advised us and concurred with me that this legal opinion is correct. And so that's how we have proceeded. And in fact, I was just having a conversation today with an attorney in Washington who has met with John Podesta, who is Obama's senior advisor, about this and about what the legal basis, because even this attorney didn't really know what the legal basis was for us coming forward over the last 15 years with all this explosive information. And I said, well, it's because between 1992 and 2000, I met with so many of these senior officials who were being lied to, and you cannot claim on the one hand to invoke the law when you're sitting there breaking it every single day of your life. And that's what they're doing. These are rogue, out of control, illegal, unconstitutional programs. So so long as they stay on the wrong side of the truth and of the law, they really can't cite the law to protect themselves.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah, so that's really what we're doing, and that's, you know, but it is exciting that John Podesta actually stepped out on this. Of course, it ended up on Fox News and everywhere else. It made a, you know, headlines all over the world, as I'm sure you're aware, or anyone who follows the news. But you know, what's interesting is this backstory of, you know, how he got involved and interested after the Disclosure Project launched in 2001. And, you know, we're coming up on the 14th year anniversary of that. By the way, there's also a link on our website where people can see the entire two-hour National Press Club event that made history back then. And there's also a film. We just came out with the biggest, largest crowdfunded documentary in history is one called Sirius, S-I-R-I-U-S. By the way, that's a star system. That's the brightest star in the sky.
Mm-hmm.
And that can be viewed, if you go on our website, SiriusDisclosure.com, you can view that. It's a two-hour feature film that really deals with all these issues. It deals with the technology behind the UFOs. It deals with the secrecy.
I have a question about that. You had a little, like, 6-inch alien skeleton there.
Yeah, yeah. And
do you have any?
Well, we don't know what it is. Now, let me be clear.
Okay.
It's a 6-inch, 6 to 8-year-old child. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm a doctor. I'm an emergency doctor, but I've delivered a couple of hundred children. There are no 6 to 8-year-old humans that are only 6 inches tall. Now, the world's expert on skeletal abnormalities, Dr. Lockman at Stanford University, looked at this, looked at the CAT scans, and said, there is no syndrome that would explain this, but by looking at the epiphyseal plates, the long bones, and how the plates have developed, it's at least a 6-year-old child of some type. And now we had the genetic work done, and this, of course, became, I've heard many people, they may realize, in 2013, I think it was in April of 2013, it was the number one story on the Huffington Post for almost an entire week. And unfortunately, there was a man doing the genetic work, Dr. Gary Nolan at Stanford, who said that we have to assume, until we can prove otherwise, it's a deformed human. But the fact is that it cannot be a human once you conclude that it's at 6 years old, because even a human fetus at, you know, 20 weeks would be about that size. But you're not going to be up walking around. And you can look at the skeletal development and tell that this was a child that had been up walking around for 6 years at least. So we know that this is not a normal human, a Homo sapien. Then the genetics came back, and only 91% was matching with humans. Now, to tell you, to give an idea how crazy that is, a chimpanzee or a gorilla is 98.5% the same as a human, and a Neanderthal is 99.5% identical to Homo sapiens. And so you have something that is more different from us than we are from monkeys. You see what I'm saying? It's a huge genetic difference. And then we found out just very recently that the genes that control for the very short stature of this creature were not the result of a mutation, but were normal inherited genes, meaning that, to use the words of Dr. Nolan at Stanford, who is one of the world's experts in this area, he said it is, the chances that it's a mutation and a deformity are, quote, infinitesimally small. So what does that mean? That's a polite way of saying this is not a mutated human. This is something else. Now something else doesn't mean extraterrestrial. It could be something that is partially ET, but the species has lived in that area of Chile in the Atacama Desert for 100,000 years. We just don't know. But we do know we have something very, very unusual, and it is featured in this film, Sirius. And there's an entire report. In fact, if anyone wants to, they can look at the 3D CAT scans and X-rays and the report from Dr. Lockman at Stanford about this. It's all on our website under evidence.
Very intriguing, very intriguing. So if somebody has some knowledge, they can come and research and help with the analyzation. Is that what you're saying?
Because well, no, I believe I'm saying if the public wants to learn about this, they can. Certainly if anyone has any knowledge of this or another sample, then that would become dispositive. I mean, the sine qua non of science is sort of empirical reproducibility. And if you have a species like this, and if you find another one that's identical to it, then the chances that it's anything other than a totally different species becomes zero. You know you've got something. So what I would love to do if we had funding for it, and this is one of our problems, I mean, we've been doing this as a volunteer organization for 25 years, and as you can imagine, this subject doesn't attract any government funding, and it doesn't attract much private funding. So we do have a donation page on our website people can donate to, but we would really like to go to the Atacama Desert in Chile and mount a proper scientific expedition, because we believe from reports that there have been UFOs being seen going into the Andean foothills in the desert there, and other people have reported seeing these small, what appear to be ET creatures, and there are reports, although we haven't been able to confirm it, that there are others of these that have deceased or been killed or something that are still in that area. So yeah, obviously this would be a huge research expedition to take a scientific team down there, because you have to have people who really know what they're doing with ground penetrating radar and sonar and all kinds of archaeological experience and logistics experience. I mean, you're not going to do that for, $300 or $400. But, it'd be several hundred thousand dollars, which unfortunately we do not have.
Absolutely.
But it needs to be done, because there's something very mysterious about this. I just call it the Atacama mystery, because, here's this little creature that came out of the Atacama Desert that the top experts at Stanford University cannot explain what it is, even to this day.
With the technology we have right now today, and how much we know, it's really hard for me to believe that we don't know what this little half-foot alien is. And it's just hard for me to believe that, because, I'm one of those people who believe there's no questions out here that cannot be answered. So, I just feel like there's something that should be told about that, or that's soon going to be told. I'm not quite sure. What do you think? I mean, I just can't let go of this little half-foot alien. It fascinates me.
Yeah, well, I think it is what it looks like. I mean, if someone were to put me under truth serum, I'd say that it is almost certainly a non-human species and of extraterrestrial origin. And by the way, there are many native cultures that have traditions of having had contact with ETs, and also in that part of the world with what they call the small people, the very, very small people. So if this was a 6 to 8-year-old that was only 6 inches tall, you can imagine that the adults might be less than a foot, less than 12 inches.
We're running out of time. We didn't get into the book, your collaboration with the book that's coming out. I'm not sure if it's coming out, if it's out already, or...
Actually, there's a book called Volstock, which is by Steve Alton. Steve Alton is a New York Times bestselling author, and it has a lot of CSETI and disclosure project information in the book. It's a novel, but it's a novel that's what he calls faction. It's part fiction and part true, but he's actually woven an enormous amount of this information into this novel, and it's very well written and very entertaining. So that's really interesting. People can actually get that book now at most booksellers or on Amazon or wherever. It's called V-O-L-S-T-O-C-K, Volstock. And he and I are actually collaborating on a movie script for a full-length feature film and also another book that would be based purely on all the research I've done. But, you know, he's such a fantastic writer. I mean, I'm a medical doctor. I don't pretend to be a fantastic literary author, although I've written four books. I mean, I'm not any kind of writer like Steve Alton is. Steve Alton is just an amazing writer. And literally, I mean, he sold millions of copies of his books. I mean, he's a very renowned novelist. So it's great that he's taken an interest, and he's actually working this E.T. thing.